Hey everyone, I hope you're doing great. In this video, I'll be diving into a fantastic tool called Timeshift. You might recall me briefly mentioning it in my previous first 5 things after installing Linux Mint video, but today, we're going to delve deeper into this gem. Timeshift is a backup and restore solution similar to the system restore in Windows and Time Machine in Mac OS. It can safeguard your system by capturing incremental backups of it at set intervals. You can restore these later, reversing all system changes. These system backups are called snapshots in Timeshift, and I can't tell you how many times Timeshift has saved my system in my time. This is one tool I can really recommend to everyone. Timeshift was originally crafted by Tony George, but now belongs to the XApp project, part of Linux Mint's ecosystem. It can work in 2 different modes, BTRFS and rsync. In this video, I will only talk about rsync mode, because that's the one that works on all Linux systems. The other one, as its name suggests, requires BTRFS, but most Linux systems, including Linux Mint, use ext4 as default and can't use it. In rsync mode, Timeshift creates snapshots utilizing rsync and hard links. That makes snapshots compact and quick to make. Each snapshot is a complete backup that you can explore using a file manager. We will talk more about that in a bit. Timeshift snapshot is not meant to be a full backup, but rather a system-focused backup. What that means is that snapshot should include essential system files necessary for your computer's functioning, but not your personal files, like photos or documents. So for that, we need to set up the Timeshift in the right way. So let's do that. To configure Timeshift, we need to click on the Settings button. If this is your first time using it, you'll encounter a welcome screen that guides you through each tab, which is essentially identical to what you'll see next. You can close that welcome screen and click on Settings to access the same screen as I do if you prefer. So, first thing we need to set up is to pick the mode, BTRFS or rsync. Since our system is using the ext4 file system, BTRFS is unavailable, so we'll go with rsync. Next settings tab is called Locations, and this one is really important. This tab allows you to choose where your Timeshift backups will be stored. Timeshift will always place its backups within a folder called Timeshift, located on the root of the partition we select here, and selecting the right partition is an important decision. First, and if you ask me, the worst option is to put your backups on your system root partition. This is bad for a few reasons. First of all, if your root partition fails for any reason, including hardware failure, your backup will be lost too. Second is space. Your backup will consume space on your root partition, which can quickly fill up, leaving you with limited system space. And remember that a full system root partition can prevent your computer from booting up. So, our next option is to put our backup on the same drive, but on a separate partition. This approach mitigates the risk of the root partition becoming too full, and can help if your root partition gets corrupted. However, it still won't be of any use if your primary drive fails. This brings us to our next option, storing Timeshift snapshots on a partition on a different drive. This approach works even if your primary drive fails and doesn't consume system drive's root space. Here in this menu, we can see the list of all drives, and under them, we see all partitions they contain. I have a second drive here with a backup partition I prepared, so I will select it. As you can see, this drive is about 44 gigabytes in size, which is about twice the data size on the root partition. Your backup partition should have more free space than the data size you're backing up. I would recommend that your backup partition is 2 or 3 times the size of your root partition. If space is limited, I would suggest at least 1.5 times the size of your root drive as a minimum. Moving on to the Schedule tab, we can set up automatic snapshots and determine how many we want. We can have snapshots taken on every boot, with a snapshot created each time we start our system. We can also have hourly snapshots taken every hour, daily snapshots taken each day, weekly snapshots taken every week, and monthly snapshots taken each month. We need to select the ones we want with a check mark. You might have noticed the numbers beside them, which decide how many snapshots of each kind we want. For example, 5 daily snapshots means that snapshots will be taken daily, but after 5 days, the oldest daily snapshot will be deleted, and a new one created for day 6. The same rule applies to all of them. Snapshots are taken until the number you selected at the time interval they belong to, after which the oldest one is deleted and a new one is created. Boot and hourly snapshots make no sense to me for a home computer. So what we need to check is daily, weekly, and monthly. I usually select a few daily snapshots, 1 or 2 weekly ones. And if it's a system I'll use for an extended period, I add 2 monthly backups for cases where problems arise before they're noticeable. Next up is the Users tab, where you can view home folders for all users, such as Root and Crystal for me. By default, this excludes all files from their home folders, but this means that settings for all user apps are not backed up and restored later. So I prefer to select Include Only Hidden Files here because it allows us to back up app config files, which are usually hidden files and exclude user files. Also, if you save your files on a separate partition and not in your home folder, you only have app settings in your home, so you should just include your home folder then. It's important to exclude your personal files because they will be deleted and modified during restore if they are included. Moving on to the Filers tab, we can exclude or include specific folders and files we want or don't want to backup. Just click on the right Add button and add your file or folder to the list, and then put a dot under the plus sign to include it or under the minus sign to exclude it. Lastly, the MISC tab. Here, you can set the date format for naming your backups. I prefer the default option, but select your preferred format. Finally, click OK. We talked about creating snapshots automatically, but we can also create them with Create button manually. This is good for creating a first system snapshot right away or creating a snapshot right before you do something you consider risky for your system. Creating the first snapshot may take some time, as you're backing up all files, but snapshots after that are a lot faster and smaller due to the use of hard links. You see, when Timeshift creates a snapshot, it checks the older snapshots, and if the same file already exists in an older snapshot, it uses a hard link to point to the older file instead of writing it again. This means all files are written only once, which saves a lot of space. After a first snapshot, sequential ones can take less than 100 megabytes if you didn't write anything new or update your system. This is really important for daily snapshots. Also, this allows us to put a bunch of snapshots on a partition that is only a few times bigger than our main drive. I will create one more snapshot now just to show you how much faster it is, because nothing has changed. As you can see, our free space hasn't decreased at all. And this is where you can see how much space you have on your Timeshift partition. We can also delete any snapshot we want by selecting it and clicking Delete button. Now let me show you something really cool. While we can restore the whole snapshot, we don't have to. Each snapshot is a full copy of our file system, and we can go into it and just take files we need. So let's select the snapshot from the date we want to use. Click on Browse, and we get that snapshot opened in our file manager, and it's the same starting point as our system root. From here, we can find any file we need. For example, let's say we need to restore this config file for X11. So we just copy it. Then, return to the text edit mode of the folder path, delete everything up to localhost, and then press Enter. This will drop you in the exact same folder, but on your real system, not backup. Again, now you are on your real system, and you can mess it up. We just paste the file here, and we restored it without restoring the whole system. This is a bit more risky and advanced, but it's a great way if you don't want to change the whole system for one bad config file. So now that we've done a single file restoration, let's do a full system restore. There are two methods to do this, from the system you're restoring and from a live USB drive or even live DVD. Let's start with restoring from a system we are using. We need to open up our Timeshift and select the snapshot we want to restore, then just click Restore. Now in this menu, Timeshift fills up these few options automatically, and I never seen it make a mistake. But always make sure that all partitions are right, because a mistake here can damage your system even more. You can lose your personal data and mess up your computer. I can't overstate enough how important it is that this partition selection is done correctly. Under boot settings, we have this little menu, and for it, the defaults are usually good enough. The first option reinstalls your grub, and the second one updates it. And if you really want to be thorough, you can update your initramfs. Now that we made sure everything is correct, we can click on Next. This starts a dry run that shows us what will be restored, deleted, or modified, so we can make sure that we want these changes. Once we are sure that's what we want, just click Next. There is no going back after this point. Now this may seem a bit scary, but it's okay. Timeshift has taken over and is restoring our system. After the restore is done, the system is rebooted, and that's it. Our system is restored now. There is one more step I do, because I've seen Grub can get buggy after a reboot, and register Linux Mint as Ubuntu, and that is running sudo update grub. After that, if nothing went wrong, the restore is done. That's all good, but what if your system won't even boot? How do you run a Timeshift if you can't even reach your desktop? Well, in this case, Timeshift can be run from a live Linux system. This is the system you boot from a USB flash drive, similar to when you install Linux. If you don't know how to do that, I can't explain it in this video because it's too off topic, but there are plenty of tutorials online about booting into a live environment. For this, I recommend using Linux Mint because it has Timeshift pre-installed, but you can really use any distro, but you will have to install Timeshift on it so it can work. So give me a moment to reboot into live system. I'm back and we're now in the live Mint environment, not the installed one. Now let's search for Timeshift in the menu. It asks us about the mode again, just click next. And here we need to select the partition we use to back up our data. Remember, this is a live environment, so this Timeshift doesn't know what we did up until now. All of this is new to it. Just click finish after selecting. And here they are. We can see our snapshots from before. So let's select one and click restore. It's all the same steps as last time. Select partitions and all that. And now it's building a dry list, just like last time. And now again, once you make sure this is all okay, just click next and then next again. Instead of that gray full screen, we get this because we are not restoring the system we are using. A few months ago, after a bad NVIDIA driver update, I couldn't even boot my system. But I had daily snapshots from yesterday and this solved my problem in minutes. I was really glad I had this setup. Anyway, now just click close and reboot your system. Of course, set your system so it boots from your drive instead of live media. And now we're back in our restored system. Again, if on Mint I do sudo update grub to fix it showing Ubuntu and grub. And after that, it's all done. I hope this video has been helpful, and thank you for watching until the end. If you enjoyed it, give it a thumbs up. If you like my content, consider subscribing, as there's more on the way. Have fun tinkering with your computer.